Stanford University.
So our speaker is Mark Van Raamsdonk, who's a professor at UBC. He did his PhD at Princeton, but his truly formative scientific years were as a postdoc here at Stanford. A few years ago, he wrote an essay, really, arguing that space-time was actually built up from entanglement. At the time, it was visionary, it was speculative, but since then, well, it inspired a lot of us, but since then, he has really been doing wonderful work putting mathematical teeth on that kind of vague speculation. And so he's going to tell you about that today. But I'd also like to point out that the reason he's here in the context of the kickoff meeting for a collaboration called It from Qubit, funded by the Simons Foundation, which is a grouping of theoretical physicists, quantum information theorists, who all believe in the view that Mark has so beautifully articulated, that quantum information theory has something very profound to say about the structure of space and time. So in the room today, you may recognize a number of our recent colloquium speakers. There's John Preskill, well, I guess Scott Aronson didn't quite make it, he just had to leave. Rob Myers, who spoke recently. Lenny Susskind, of course, you know him. But you gave a colloquium a couple of years ago. And a number of other very eminent, accomplished, wonderful theoretical physicists. You'll recognize the Maldacenas and the Polchinskis and a number of other people. We're just delighted to have them here at Stanford.
If you are a famous theoretical physicist, you're modest, too.
All right. So if any of the students or postdocs get inspired by what Mark is telling you about today, we're going to have a whole set day of meetings tomorrow. You're welcome to join us. Students, if you're interested, we're going to be running summer schools as part of this collaboration. Make sure to come talk to us and sign up. But without further ado, Mark.
Okay, well, thanks a lot for the chance to speak here. Actually, Patrick wasn't lying when he said that being here as a postdoc, I think, contributed enormously to my development as a physicist. And I think, actually, specifically just seeing people being brave enough to really think about big questions, that was one of the things that I got out of being here. And the other thing that Patrick said, also I think is really true, that it's an exciting convergence of fields that has been happening in the last 5 years or more. Gravity really and quantum mechanics are coming together in a way that's more remarkable than I think any of us would have predicted. Okay. So this has been one of the biggest challenges in theoretical physics in the last decades. How do you understand gravity in the framework of quantum mechanics, which we think of as, in some sense, the basic framework, the basic set of rules for doing physics in our universe? And of course, mostly you don't really need to combine these things if you want to build a better iPhone or whatever. It's not going to involve gravity. But there are certain situations. If you really want to understand black holes, if you want to understand how the universe began, understand what was the Big Bang, then you need a theoretical framework that includes both of these things. So just to remind everyone, I'm sure I don't need to do this, but when we talk about gravity, this is the Einstein version of gravity. So gravity usually has an I in it. This is the dynamics of space-time and how it changes and interacts with matter. Okay, and of course the central equation in classical gravitational physics is the equation of Einstein that says that if you have energy and momentum, and energy flow and momentum flow, well, this creates intrinsic curvature of space-time, and those are related directly like that. And so I guess part of the reason why fitting this into the framework of quantum mechanics is difficult is that the actual space that your physics is living on is dynamical. Okay, we very successfully took electromagnetism and combined it with quantum mechanics. It wasn't trivial, but it's been done, and the other interactions and forces in nature, we've combined them, and it all fits together very nicely. In in models that we'd call quantum field theory. So the standard model of particle physics is a quantum field theory. And that's just that's a quantum mechanical system where the space-time is just fixed. But it's harder to incorporate gravity because there you need to actually understand the quantum fluctuations of space-time itself. Okay. So the field of string theory gave us a lot of progress in this direction. But I think in some ways the first sort of truly complete model that came out of string theory, the first truly complete model of quantum gravity came in 1997. This was through the ADS-CFT correspondence of Maldacena. And what it says is that certain examples of theories of quantum gravity, so quantum mechanical theories that are describing this dynamical space-time, are actually exactly equivalent by some amazing connection to just ordinary quantum mechanical systems where the space-time is not fluctuating. So just to give you an idea of how that works, I'm sure you've heard colloquy on this topic before, but just as a reminder, so you've got an ordinary quantum system. Usually it takes the form of a quantum field theory. So you can think of something like electrodynamics, where you have some fields, but now they're quantum mechanical. These examples tend to have very large numbers of fields. Okay. But just like any quantum field theory, you can have a state that's the lowest energy state of the system. So there's a quantum vacuum state. And the idea would be that somehow that corresponds, or that is encoding the information about a big empty space-time with nothing in it. We'll talk more about the details of what kind of space-time that is. I could also add in a little bit of energy. I could add in some excitation into my field theory. And so that would be a different quantum state of the field theory. And that might correspond to a small excitation in the space-time, like having a gravity wave go through there. Or I could add a lot of energy on the field theory side. And then on the gravity side, you could have something that's looks qualitatively different. We know in gravitational physics, if you put in lots and lots of energy, you can form things like black holes. And so even something as exotic as a black hole is being described through a more or less ordinary state of the quantum field theory. It just happens to have a lot of energy in it. Okay, so that proposal has been around since 1997, and we now have, I think, more than 10,000 papers citing that original work. So in those papers, a lot of the papers were trying to find evidence to check whether this is true, whether it's consistent to make this connection between a gravitational theory and a non-gravitational theory. And so far, everything that people have done over those last 18 years has shown or has suggested that it's entirely consistent. But somehow, through all that, we still don't have a really good answer to why this works. So it's an amazing thing that through the quantum dynamics of a bunch of more or less ordinary fields, through some mysterious correspondence, you are actually describing gravitational physics. And so we'd like to understand, as a big, broad question, how does the space-time emerge from the story? And how does gravitational physics emerge from the story? And how are those things encoded in these more or less ordinary kinds of quantum field theories that are much like the standard model? Okay. So the really exciting thing that I'll give some of the history of this, but I think maybe started in 2001 and certainly by 2005, 2006, so certainly before I was interested in the subject. There's this suggestion that understanding not conventional field theory physics like scattering amplitudes and correlation functions, but thinking about the quantum field theory in the way that a quantum information theorist would think about it. So asking about things like entanglement, but in the context of the quantum field theory, and other quantum information quantities. That's a crucial step if we want to understand how gravity is emerging, how space-time is being described. So since it's a colloquium, I'm going to start really basic and just make sure that everyone remembers what entanglement is. And I'm going to start with a single spin. So this is the simplest possible quantum system, a two-state quantum system. And since I'm a theorist, that looks a little bit naked. So I'm going to put some clothes on it. So this is now referring to the state of this two-state system. So this is just, say, describing a vector in the Hilbert space of a spin system. So this would be one particular state where the spin is up. And then, of course, the fundamental thing in quantum mechanics is that the set of possible states of that quantum system is a vector space. So you have basis states. And if I want to write the general state, I just take a linear superposition of these things. Okay, so this is the core property of quantum mechanics, that you have quantum superposition, that your states are in a vector space. Okay, so entanglement comes about when we think about systems that have more than one part. So the simplest such system would be going to the case where you have two spins. Okay, and now the basic description of a system like that would be that each of those spins could be up or down, and that you could have these basic states up, 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 down, down, up, and down, down. But again, the most general state would come by taking a quantum superposition of those states. So mathematically, it's just a linear combination of these four things, which are vectors in the space describing the two-spin system. Okay. And so there's a crucial point. When I have a state like that with general coefficients A, B, C, and D, then I cannot generally write that as some factorized thing like this. So it's not true that when I write this down, I can't say, OK, the first spin is in this quantum superposition, and the second spin is in this other quantum superposition. It's just impossible to give a description like that. OK, there are states like that. But most of the states do not have a description like that. And for most of these states where you can't write it like that, we would say that spin one is entangled with spin two. Okay, so example, not entangled. This is in one state, this is in another state. Another one that's not entangled is this superposition. Because I could factorize it, the second spin actually is definitely down. And the first spin is in this superposition. And then you have examples which are more generic where the two are entangled. So this up, up, plus down, down, you can't write it as the state of one spin and then the state of the other spin. OK, so this is sort of a basic entangled state that we'll be thinking about. All right, so now I'm going to jump right back into quantum gravity, into the ADS-CFT correspondence. And I'm going to tell you about a paper that Juan Maldacena wrote in 2001. And this paper was something that, so when I had a sabbatical in 2009, and I decided to sit down and think about, well, how could I make progress towards these big questions of understanding this ADS-CFT correspondence? And I just wanted to see, well, what's the most interesting thing out there that I don't really understand that seems different? And it was this paper by Maldacena. And in Maldacena's paper, so he was trying to think about, so remember we talked about different field theory states describing different space-times. Well, Maldacena wanted to describe a space-time that has two what we'd call asymptotic regions. So imagine two big empty space-times, but they're not quite empty because each one of them has a black hole in it. Okay. And these black holes are connected behind their horizons. Okay. So when you take a general relativity course and learn about black holes for the first time, you learned that a black hole geometry can be extended smoothly into this into what we'd call a maximally extended spacetime, black hole spacetime, and it looks like this. Okay. So Maldacena said, well, how do you describe something like that using this ADS-CFT correspondence? And what he said was, well, since you actually have really, apart from that black hole, you have two separate spacetimes, there should actually be two of these quantum field theories involved. But there's something in the geometry that relates them, and it's this wormhole that connects the two black holes behind the horizon. But what Maldacena said was not that those two field theories have any kind of interaction with each other. The only relation was, in his description of this spacetime, was to say that the two quantum field theories are in an entangled state. And he said that the field theory description of this spacetime, according to the ADS-CFT correspondence, is a state that looks basically just like that up, up, down, down state that we just wrote down for the spin system. What he said was, well, just write down all of the possible energy eigenstates of the field theory system, and then take this sum of states where it's vacuum state in one, vacuum state in another, superpose that with this state where there's a little excitation and the same excitation, and just keep going. And there are some coefficients there that I didn't write. But it's basically just a big entangled state like that spin system. Okay. So this is the remarkable thing. Just to summarize, he was saying, here's an interesting space-time where it's like two space-times, except they're connected behind a black hole horizon. And he proposed, I won't give all of the arguments, but that this is actually going to be described in this correspondence by taking two completely independent physical systems and just entangling them in a particular way. Okay. So when I was thinking about that, I wondered whether, well, so what that suggested was that maybe, I mean, what could it be that this entanglement in that example, is it the entanglement that's the crucial thing that connects the two spacetimes? And then what I was learning at the time when I was reading about more about entanglement based on that, and so I realized, or I didn't realize, but I read that when you just have the ground state of an ordinary quantum field theory, there's actually lots of entanglement there already. So even though with that example of Maldacena, you had to put the thing in a special state, and then you had entanglement between one field theory and the other, if you go back and just consider this completely vanilla state of a single field theory, the one that had the lowest energy and the one that was dual or corresponded to completely empty space-time, well, there's actually a whole bunch of entanglement in that state already. And so, for example, if you were to divide the space in half, you would find that the quantum fields on this side would be entangled with the quantum fields in that side. Okay, so in the room here, the electric field over here is entangled with the electric field over there. Okay. And so then this led me to wonder, well, could that entanglement have something to do with the fact that you've got this nice, smooth space-time? And so so I thought about this thought experiment where you take that vacuum state and you just vary the state. So we're free to consider any state that we want in this field theory that's supposed to have a gravity dual description. And so I could consider like a one parameter family of states where you start out with that very entangled ground state, and then you just arbitrarily draw a line halfway down the middle, and you start removing entanglement. You change the state so that now, in this case, there's a little bit less entanglement between here and here than there used to be, and here there's even less. And so what happened, I tried to do this and think about what would happen on the gravity side using whatever tools that were available. And what seemed to happen was that you had this big empty space-time, but then as you remove entanglement, it just starts to deform itself. It starts to pinch itself apart, kind of like you had a big wad of gum and you're just stretching it out. And what happened is that the two, the two edges of the spacetime are getting further and further apart. And in some sense, the middle of it is getting narrower and narrower, just like in the picture. Okay, so by removing the entanglement that was there in the field theory state to start with, then it seems that the space, this completely empty space, it actually starts deforming and ripping apart into two pieces. And then you could consider dividing your field theory into more parts and removing more entanglement between more of the parts. And eventually what seemed to happen was that your entire space-time just rips apart into tiny pieces and you have nothing left. Okay. And so in a sense, going backwards, that suggests, so this is all very qualitative, but it suggested that this classical space-time geometry that you had that was being described by the vacuum state of the field theory, somehow maybe it emerges by through all this entanglement between the quantum fields in different parts of space in the field theory picture. Okay. And so in a sense, you get this really dramatic statement that, quantum mechanics being something that's difficult to reconcile with space-time, in this description of space-time, it's actually quantum mechanics that's underlying space-time. And you wouldn't have space-time without quantum entanglement in the auxiliary system. Okay. And I should mention that around that same time, Brian Swingle, who was a graduate student at MIT, had a similar idea based on a more condensed matter background, thinking about tensor networks. Okay, so that was all very quantitative. I think vague was the word Patrick used. And so obviously, we would like to be able to put some meat on those statements and tell a more quantitative story to see whether this is really true. So the first thing that we need to do in order to make progress in that direction, I needed to tell you more about how to quantify entanglement. Okay, so up until now, we just talked about either the system is entangled or it's not entangled. But entanglement is something that for which we have various quantitative measures. Okay, so let's go back to the two-spin system. Okay. And we could ask this question, what is the state of the first spin? So say someone gives me this state of the two spins, what is the state of the first spin? And I basically already told you that there's not going to be, that the answer is not going to look like this. Okay? There is no state of this form for a single spin that will give the same results for measurements as if I measured the first spin in this general state. So that's another way of saying that that you can't, that there are definitely states that have entanglement. And so instead, what you have to consider is a more general concept. So if I have a state with a couple of spins and I want to know what is the state of the first spin, how do I describe that? The way to describe it is through what we call an ensemble. Okay? So there's no single quantum state that will reproduce all those measurements. But it turns out that you can always reproduce the measurements by thinking about a collection of quantum states. I could take them to be orthogonal if I like. And probabilities, just classical probabilities, P1 and P2. And this ensemble of things, it'll be possible for me to choose the states and the probabilities so that that ensemble will reproduce the measurements that I would have in my original state, or reproduce, say, expectation values. Okay. And so in the ensemble, to calculate an expectation value, for example, I just take the expectation value in this state, multiply it by that probability, calculate the expectation value in that state, multiply it by that probability, and add it up. Okay, so I can always find such an ensemble that will reproduce the measurements in the full state. And so we would say that the subsystem is not described by a pure state, but rather by an ensemble. Okay. And the fact that you have these classical probabilities, we could sometimes describe that as saying that there's some classical uncertainty about the state of the first spin. Okay, so just a couple of examples that we talked about before. If I looked at these not entangled states, well, then I could say definitely that the first spin is just up with probability 1. So that's a really trivial ensemble. Same thing with this one. This first spin is in the state up plus down with probability 1. But in the entangled state, to reproduce the measurements on that I would get by measuring the first spin in this system, what I would have to do is consider an ensemble where you have up with probability 1/2 and down with probability 1/2. Okay. And it's important that those two are not the same, because, for example, if I computed an expectation value, there would be cross terms in using that one and not with that. Okay. So given this description of, so entangled means that I'm going to get some probabilities which are not just 1 and then 0. Entangled means I'll get a non-trivial ensemble with different probabilities. But now I can start to understand how to quantify entanglement. So if I look at this state and compare it with this one, well, naively, we would say this one is really close to the state up, up, which is not entangled. So we would say maybe that's less entangled. But these probabilities give us a way to quantify that. Okay. So this one is 99 over 100, and this is 1 over 100. And we're used to quantifying, so entanglement, having these probabilities, having classical uncertainty, this is all familiar. And it's familiar from statistical mechanics. Okay. So the other place, the first place we normally see ensembles would be when you're thinking about systems at finite temperature or systems interacting with heat baths. And then you talk about various kinds of ensembles. So you have sets of quantum states with various probabilities. This would be the microcanonical ensemble or the canonical ensemble. You would have these Boltzmann weights as the probabilities. And in that case, we have a very well-developed way of how do you quantify the classical uncertainty that's inherent in talking about an ensemble. And that is the entropy. So this is just the ordinary, if you plug in either this one or this one, these will give you the ordinary formulas for entropy in either the microcanonical ensemble or the canonical ensemble. Okay, so this is just a general way of quantifying the classical uncertainties in ensembles. And so that is the most natural way when we come down to asking how do you quantify entanglement. Okay. Well, since entanglement is basically equivalent to having this classical uncertainty in the ensemble describing the subsystem, we could just use entropy. Okay, so here's say a general quantum system. We consider a subsystem. That subsystem will be described by some particular ensemble. I can find some orthogonal states there and probabilities there. And now if I wanted to say, well, what is the entropy of that ensemble, I just use that same formula. Okay. And we could use that subsystem entropy as our measure. It's one possible measure, a very natural measure of how much entanglement there is in a system. Okay. So in some ways, calling it entanglement entropy, it obscures the fact that it's really just the regular entropy of the subsystem. Okay. Okay, so now we have a quantitative measure of entanglement in systems. And now the next piece of the story is that quantitative measure is going to be precisely related to something quantitative in our description of the spacetimes that these states are supposed to describe. Okay, so entanglement entropy in CFT is quantitatively related to spacetime geometry. Okay, so this, it turns out, is actually just it's in some sense a beautiful generalization of something that we already knew. Okay. So this statement, this connection, which is going to be in some sense, people have described it as a Rosetta Stone for understanding the connection between quantum mechanics and gravity, if you ask, well, where was the first place that we saw it? It was actually the work of Jacob Bekenstein in 1972. And so what he observed was that in gravitational physics, there appears to be some connection between a geometrical quantity, the area of a black hole horizon, and a thermodynamic quantity, entropy. Okay, so he observed that the area in black hole geometries obeys various laws, like a first law and a second law, that are qualitatively similar to laws of thermodynamics, and suggested that this area can actually be interpreted as the entropy of a black hole. Okay. We understand that now in the context of ADS-CFT. So at the time, people didn't have the tools to really understand what that entropy was counting. What kind of ensemble were you talking about? Let me explain that connection in the modern context of this ADS-CFT correspondence. Okay. So this ADS-CFT correspondence is saying that you have a description of a gravitational theory, which is just a quantum field theory. I've drawn it living on a sphere instead of a plane. So remember I said that to describe a black hole through this correspondence, you just put a whole bunch of energy into the field theory. Okay. And so our understanding now is that the fundamental description of this black hole in this spacetime being described this way would just be a field theory, say, in a very high energy thermal state. Okay. Well, now we have an understanding of what this entropy could be counting. So in the gravity picture, you've got the area of the black hole horizon. It's behaving like an entropy. And the reason is it is the entropy in the fundamental description, in this field theory description that we're using to define our theory of quantum gravity. Okay. So the field theory is in the canonical ensemble. You have all these probabilities. You can calculate the entropy. And then the connection would be that the area of that black hole horizon is equal to the entropy of the field theory. So that was a connection seen in 1972. Now we understand it in ADS-CFT. And the statement about entanglement entropy, I think you should understand this as a massive and beautiful generalization of that statement. Okay. So what Ryu and Takayanagi basically said was, well, instead of considering the entropy of the entire field theory when you're in a thermal state, suppose you're in just any old state of the field theory that has one of these, we're in a field theory that where you have a state that has a gravity dual description. So it's it's a special field theory that actually is connected to gravity somehow. And we're in a state where you have a certain geometry. Maybe it has a black hole, maybe it doesn't have a black hole. And now they said, well, don't even consider the whole field theory, just consider a part of it, any old part of that field theory. And compute the entropy of that. Okay, so compute the subsystem, the ensemble describing the subsystem, compute its entropy, and they said even that even that thing has a geometrical interpretation as some kind of area in the dual geometry. Okay, so we went from looking at just a particular class of states, black hole states, and the entropy of the whole thing, and we said that entropy was dual to a certain area, the black hole horizon. After Ryu and Takayanagi, we can consider any state, we can consider any subsystem of this field theory that is defining our gravity theory, and the subsystem entropy corresponds to some area in the spacetime. Okay, so I'm gonna tell you more about this. I think at this point I probably need to tell you more about what entropy of a region of a field theory means. You might not really have a good picture of that. And I need to tell you why they would have suggested this. And I will tell you exactly which area they were talking about. OK, so I want to start with just what does this entanglement entropy mean in quantum field theory? We'll start with a really simple example, going back to the spins, just so you see something very specific. Remember, we were talking about states like this, where you could choose the coefficients here. And so just so you can see what it looks like, if I vary the coefficient alpha between 0 and 1, then this entropy of the subsystem, the entropy of the first spin, well, it increases from 0. It's maximum when those are equal, and it goes back down to 0. Okay, so we can easily imagine doing that calculation. We just calculate these probabilities, plug it into the formula. Okay. The next step towards field theory would be to consider, instead of two spins, we have two oscillators. Really, the only difference is you have now an infinite number of possible basis elements. But if I have two uncoupled oscillators, then the ground state looks like that, and there's no entanglement between them. If I have a coupling between them, okay, well, then I have to do some harder work to figure out what the ground state of that system is. It's a good third-year quantum mechanics problem. And the answer looks like this. Okay, and now, because you have this superposition, you realize that now the quantum states of the two spins are correlated. You have entanglement. And you could go ahead and, again, you could calculate the entanglement entropy between the two oscillators in the ground state of that system. Okay, so you would basically be doing a linear algebra problem of taking that set of coefficients and finding eigenvectors and eigenvalues of the matrix here. Okay, so that's what entanglement would mean for oscillators. And now you can consider a whole bunch of oscillators. Okay, so once you get to more interesting systems like that with lots of parts, there's actually lots of different entanglement entropies that you could talk about. I could talk about this particular oscillator. That one's going to be described by some ensemble of single oscillator states, and it has an entropy. Or I could consider that combination, or I could consider those three, or I could even consider some disconnected kind of combinations. So starting from the ground state of the system, I could actually ask about the entropy of any possible subsystem. So there's actually a lot of information there when I start asking about entropies in quantum systems. Okay, so field theory, well, the simplest example of a field theory would just be, you know, it's just a continuous system. And one way to get to a field theory would just be to consider a system like all those oscillators coupled together and then take a limit where I'm only interested in physics at very large scales compared to the oscillator distance. Okay. So there's a natural thing to look at in that kind of situation, and that would be, well, how does the entanglement entropy, or how does this subsystem entropy behave as I look at larger and larger subsystems? And so there's a nice result for this particular system of balls and springs. In the limit where this L is much larger, or that the L contains many, many balls, you get an answer that looks like this. So L divided by epsilon. A technical point is that this quantity is actually, when you take a limit of epsilon going to 0 with L fixed, it actually diverges. So you have to be careful, as usual in quantum field theory, to work with quantities that are finite in the limit where you have continuous physical quantities. But you could consider things like the derivative of that quantity with respect to L, or differences between fix the subsystem and consider the difference of entropy of a given state compared to the ground state. So the field theory that set of balls and springs defines is actually a very special one, because it turns out in the continuum limit it has a scaling symmetry. One can actually prove that any quantum field theory with a similar symmetry as that one, as that simple one defined in terms of the balls and the springs, actually has an answer that also looks like that. And the only difference is that you have a different coefficient in front. So this is actually a universal answer for the entanglement entropy of a subsystem of the ground state of a conformal field theory. So the field theories with these scaling symmetries. Okay. And it was this answer that I think inspired Ryu and Takayanagi to make the connection with gravity. Because it turns out this answer right here is also the answer to an interesting geometry problem. Okay. So it's the answer to a quantum mechanics problem. It's the answer to a geometry problem as well. So now I'll tell you the geometry problem. So the geometry problem is to consider a space. And so this is supposed to be something like a projection of a certain curvy space. So like when you project the globe onto a flat map, and distances on the map up near, at least it used to be distances up here, were actually shorter than they looked, and distances near the equator were longer than the ones up here. So that's what these lizards are supposed to represent. The lizards tell you the axial distance between points in this curvy space that's being represented this way. Okay, so this is the hyperbolic plane, and the distance between this point and this point would be the minimum number of lizards on, if I think about the various paths, the distance is just the minimum number of lizards that you have to go through to get from one point to the other. Okay, so the geometry problem for which this is the answer is just to pick any two points on the boundary. Okay, so actually it's an infinite distance to the boundary, so I define this little dotted line, and the distance there is epsilon. That's the epsilon that was there in our field theory problem. So the geometry problem is to find the minimum distance between this point and this point through the space. Okay. And you'll notice, if this were ordinary space, you would just go in a straight line from this point to this point. But in this space, you'd have to go through an awful lot of lizards to do that. And you get a shorter path, actually, by going into the middle, where the lizards are bigger. Okay, so the answer to how many lizards does it take to get from here to here for general points separated by L is log of L. It's the same answer as that field theory problem. Okay, so of course that could be a coincidence. But it turns out to work in higher dimensions as well. So if you look at the vacuum state of a conformal field theory in higher dimensions, and you consider a ball-shaped region of that, so this is some generalization of that interval, and you ask, how big is the entanglement between this region and the rest? How much is the entropy of that subsystem? It also has the same answer as a higher dimensional version of that geometry problem. Okay, so there's higher dimensional hyperbolic spaces that generalize what I showed you on the last transparency, and that answer matched as well. Okay. And so I think this, and really, of course, together with the previous connections between entropy and area that appeared in gravitational physics, suggested to Ryu and Takayanagi that we could go away from just the vacuum state, and maybe we could just consider general regions. Maybe there are certain special field theories where this connection is always true. Okay. So what I told you actually is true for absolutely any conformal field theory, the lizard answer, and this one in higher dimensions. But what they were saying is that, maybe the special thing about these ones that are describing gravity theories would be that this always works. Okay, that you could take a general state, which might be dual not to that hyperbolic space, but to some deformed version of it, and calculate the entanglement entropy of any region, the answer is still this minimal area in the corresponding spacetime. Okay. And so if that's true, if their conjecture is true, that would give us a way of looking at a quantum state in one of these theories, doing some entropy entanglement calculations, we would quantify the entanglement of various regions. And then from that information, we could potentially deduce that there's a dual geometry that's describing things here. Okay, so the procedure would be, assuming that their conjecture is true, you take your quantum state, you calculate the entanglement entropy for lots of different regions, and then you ask, is there some kind of geometry, which is not that simple hyperbolic space, but it's some curvy, deformed version of it, where for every region A, the answer to that entanglement entropy is the minimum area surface, or the area of the minimal area surface in that corresponding geometry. Okay. And that would be a way, and if you could find it, if there is a geometry that captures all that information, they would say, well, that's the way that geometry is encoded in your quantum state in this ADS-CFT correspondence. Okay. So the summary so far would be, let me just tell you that this conjecture, it's a big leap, but it turns out to pass many consistency checks. And we now have a proof, or at least, some people would call it an argument, a very compelling argument by Maldesane and Lukowitz as to why this should be generally true. Okay, so it's actually been understood. Originally, it was really just a proposal. Now it's something that's on rather firm ground. Okay, and so the summary would be: so space-time and geometry is indeed encoded in the entanglement structure of the quantum state, but now we can make that statement quantitative . I can tell you, at least in principle, how to figure out what the space-time geometry looks like if you give me the quantum state and you tell me that there's a geometry. All right, so going on from there, of course, gravity is more than just the statement that you have space-times and they can be curvy. There's some specific constraints that these space-times satisfy. Okay, they satisfy Einstein's equations. And so it's not just any geometry that's a consistent geometry in a theory of gravity. There's a very special set. And so an interesting question is, if geometry is related to the entanglement structure in some field theory states, can we actually learn about the constraints on geometries? Can we learn about space-time dynamics using some knowledge of constraints that entanglement has to obey? There's this entire field of quantum information theory where people have been, deriving results about entanglement for years. Can we take some of those, use this magic Rosetta Stone that Ryu and Takayanagi have given us, and see what they imply about the geometries described by these quantum states? Okay. And so, as an example of some of these constraints that entanglements entropies have to obey, there's actually a whole list. You can open up a textbook on quantum information theory and find things like subadditivity, which says that if I have two different subsystems, then the entropy of that one plus the entropy of that one is always greater than or equal to the entropy of the combined thing. And I have fancier versions of that strong subadditivity, and there's a list of quantities and a list of inequalities. And now we could basically look at any one of those, and if someone gives me now a geometry and they say, this geometry right here, it is encoding the entanglement structure of a quantum field theory state. Okay. Well, I can go and check, I can calculate the entanglements based on the geometry, and I can check whether these things are satisfied. And there are many geometries where those would fail to be satisfied. Okay. And so I can now learn about gravitational physics directly from these basic results of quantum mechanics. Okay. So I just have time to tell you about one example of that. And it's basically the first example that you'd think of doing. So if you start from empty space, so the vacuum state, We said that the entanglement entropies in the vacuum state of a field theory match with the areas in this hyperbolic space, or actually it's the time-dependent version of that is called anti-de Sitter space. So we already, in some sense, we've checked that anti-de Sitter space gives you entanglement entropies that seem to satisfy all the constraints. Well, now what I want to do is look at spacetimes that are close to anti-de Sitter space. So I'll just take one perturbative step away from anti-de Sitter space, consider the family of possible spacetimes, and ask out of that family, which ones are consistent with everything that I know about entanglement. So there's one particular constraint that entanglement satisfies that turns out to be very useful here. Okay. And this is basically related, it's directly related to the first law of thermodynamics. Okay. So I'm going to tell you a version of the first law of thermodynamics that might be a little bit different than the one you're familiar with. But it's the same setup. You have a system, you have a heat bath. You start out in the thermal state with temperature T. And now consider any variation of the quantum state, not necessarily one to a nearby equilibrium state as you often do in thermodynamics. Consider any variation of that state to a nearby state. Well, then it turns out that the change in entanglement entropy, which is something that I can always compute. Thermodynamic entropy, we usually assume that you're going to a nearby equilibrium state. Entanglement entropy of that system is always well defined. So I ask, how does that change if I vary the state a little bit? Well, it turns out that it's always equal to 1 over T times the change in the expectation value of the Hamiltonian for that system A. So it's kind of an exact quantum version of the first law of thermodynamics. In these conformal field theories, when you're in the vacuum state, so the simple state that I want to start from, there's a sense that I won't explain in which the ensemble describing a ball-shaped subsystem is thermal. It's not thermal with respect to the regular Hamiltonian, but there's a sense in which it's thermal with respect to some other quantum operator. I won't go into the details, but the important thing is that the previous result on the previous transparency actually applies in this case when I start from the vacuum state and when I perturb away from the vacuum state. Okay. So if I use the result, what it tells me is that the change in entanglement entropy of this ball-shaped region, as I perturb a little bit, it's related to the change in energy, in some kind of energy. And what it is, here's the energy density operator. This is the expectation value. And I integrate that over the ball with some particular weighting function that goes to 0 at the edge of the ball. Okay, so it's like a first law. It's relating a change in entropy to a change in energy. In these systems, actually, the energy density expectation value, it turns out that's related to the entanglement entropy of infinitesimal balls. So if you wanted, you could actually express this first law entirely in terms of entanglement entropies. What it would say is that if I vary my state from the vacuum state, and I calculate the change in entanglement entropies for all of those little balls, I can use that answer and do some integral and figure out what the change in entanglement entropy is for the big ball. They're not independent of one another. Okay. So because I can make that statement, which is just about entanglement entropies, and because Ryu and Takayanagi have this formula that tells us how to translate entanglement entropy to something geometrical, I can translate this first law of thermodynamics to a geometrical statement about what happens to the geometry when I perturb the quantum state. Right, so I have that big empty hyperbolic space. Now I change the state of the field theory a little bit. that's going to bring me away from the big empty space. Now we'll have a few gravity waves or something. We'll have some perturbed geometry. But this first law is going to tell us that the area of the surface, of the minimal surface that ends on this ball, it'll tell us that that area must be related to the surfaces ending on all these infinitesimal balls. Okay. So roughly speaking, this first law will tell us that the area of this thing, or the geometry around that surface in this perturbed space, is not completely independent of the geometry there at the boundary, but they're related in some way. So you get some kind of non-local constraint on the space-time. And it's, you know, it's going to be true for some space-times, not true for other space-times. And actually, it's not just one constraint. It has to be true for any ball-shaped region that I choose. Okay. So this is one example. But I could apply that first law of thermodynamics to a little ball over here, or one over here, or one at a later time. It actually applies to little balls in other kinds of other frames of reference if I go to a boosted frame. So there's actually a whole bunch of constraints. And it's a bit ugly on the surface because they're all kind of non-local about areas here and areas here. But if you do a little bit of math, it turns out that all those set of constraints that you get, if you combine them all together, they are exactly equivalent mathematically to the statement that your perturbed geometry satisfies Einstein's equations to linear order. Okay, so we're just talking about linear perturbations. And so, you know, remarkably, starting from this Ryutaki-Nagy conjecture between entanglements and space-time geometry, and then asking, well, okay, what's the most base if I start from the vacuum state and then I just perturb a little bit? You know, what kind of basic constraints do entanglement have to satisfy? And what do those tell me on the gravity side? Well, we got you know, the basic dynamical rules that space-times have to obey in theories of gravity. And so, you know, that's just the start of a program that is in progress with you know, lots of collaborators. We've started, you know, saying, well, what happens at second order in perturbations, or what happens in general? What about subadditivity or strong subadditivity? What do those things imply about geometries? So most of the things. I'll just mention one result with Brian Swingle that you know, you can actually, in a certain sense, see that the source for that linearized equation is the matter stress energy tensor in the gravity side. And so, you know, you can really start to see the structure of gravitational physics coming out. At the nonlinear level, most of the constraints are not equalities, but inequalities. But what we seem to be learning about are things like energy conditions. People in gravity often talk about certain conditions that they consider to be reasonable for realistic matter. And now you have a chance of actually proving those directly based on a fundamental quantum description of your gravity theory. Okay. So at the end of my time, to summarize, you've got this remarkable picture emerging where you started out thinking gravity and quantum mechanics are you know, two things that are difficult to combine. You know, people have used the words incompatible. But then you get the ultimate plot twist where gravity is just, you know, a different way to look at quantum mechanics. If you look at the right quantum systems and you reinterpret the fundamentally quantum things, then you get gravity. And so there's lots still to be done. There's lots of other interesting things, you know, apart from entanglement. But it seems that that this is a really, you know, quantitative connection. And it's really, I think, a fundamental thing that we're learning about how gravity works. So I'll stop there.
like.
Okay.
One is, in this framework, is there a real, you know, physical particle that would be a graviton, or would there not be? And then the second is, it would seem, it would suggest mm-hmm. that any entangled system becomes less entangled through time. But I don't know if you've had any.
Yeah, so you're talking about decoherence and or
yeah.
Okay. The first question, the answer is yes. The gravity theory here, so far we're working at the classical level, although we've considered quantum corrections at sort of the first order. But these are going to be very conventional gravitational theories where you have classical equations, and then, you know, when you include the quantum mechanics on the gravity side, the waves will be quantized and you'll get gravitons. So that's fairly clear. The other question was, what was your other question? About the...
Does any entangled system become...
Okay. So, yeah, that's interesting. So, you know, in these field theory systems, it turns out that field theory Hamiltonians really like entanglement. So, an example would be the singlet state in a hydrogen atom, right? If you just go to the lowest energy state, well, then you're in a spin singlet, which is the spin of the electron, the spin of the proton are entangled. And unless I add some energy to that system, that entanglement isn't going to go away. I mean, in quantum field theory, it's much stronger than that. I would actually have to add an infinite amount of energy if I wanted to get rid of the entanglement at short distances between the fields. So, you know, I would think about that spring picture where you have all these balls and springs together. And, you know, it's really just that they're connected physically. There are interactions between the neighboring degrees of freedom, and those naturally want the quantum states to be correlated with each other. So you don't really have the problem. Decoherence exists in a sense. Of course, the decoherence would be part of the story, but it doesn't sort of destroy space-time.
Right. Maybe I misunderstood, but...
Okay.
I'm not familiar with all of mathematics, but
yeah.
People say space-time is expanding. You know, things are becoming more and more distant. And it seems in the extreme of that, that since you said if you make the space-time less entangled, the space-time falls apart. Isn't that what we're heading to? And then, you know, at the beginning, wasn't everything like kind of maximally entangled? Is that the idea?
Yeah, this is a really good question. I mean, this is a really important thing for us to understand. So, when I was talking about this ADS-CFT correspondence, so there were lots of different space-times that we could describe. We had the big empty one, and then we had things with gravity waves or black holes or whatever. What I didn't tell you in detail was that all of those space-times that would be described by states of one of these field theories, they all kind of have the same asymptotic behavior. So they're not cosmologically expanding spacetimes. They're spacetimes, we'd call them asymptotically ADS spacetimes. So if you go really far away from any place, it just looks like empty, negatively curved space. Okay. So one of the biggest challenges in this ADS-CFT correspondence that I think, you know, is maybe the big question that a lot of us want to work towards is, well, how do you go from this, you know, great, completely well-defined description of quantum gravity in these kinds of space-times to understanding how to describe quantum mechanically quantum gravity in cosmological space-times. And my hope is actually that understanding the connections between the entanglement and geometry will give us hints. So precisely in the way that you were just describing, if we look at what is happening to the space-time in de Sitter space or in FRW cosmology, and then if I said, well, maybe in that scenario, even though I don't know the correct description quantum mechanically in terms of some field theory, I could guess that geometry is still related to entanglement somehow. And so I could ask, what features do I have to build in the dynamics of the entanglement in a quantum system that would look like the features of geometry evolving? And that could give me a guide to understanding how to go beyond these kind of boring fixed asymptotic space-times to get actual quantum descriptions of cosmological spacetimes.
Thanks, that was a good answer.
So in this Einstein equation,
so
if I consider a more general perturbation to the CFT rather than using T mu nu, so I can imagine creating two excitations, say located on two points, that are made by different orbiters so that they have the same energy. They are two excited states with the same energy but different entanglement. So does that mean like the corresponding geometry will be the same or will we see?
Well, if I ended up with exactly the same entanglement, according to the Ryutaki, actually even if I, I was a little bit, if I want to get a little bit more technical, this Ryutaki-Nagi formula, so we're talking about large N theories, and the formula that I wrote down applies to the leading large N behavior of the entanglement entropy. So I look at the entanglement entropy in the large N, the large N behavior of that is equal to the area on the gravity side. So if I had two different states, and you know all of the entanglement entropies were the same up to sort of subleading terms in N, then we would say that the geometry would be the same. If the subleading terms differed, they might have different quantum fields living on that geometry. But the black hole is actually a good example. If you think of the black hole spacetime, well, there's actually really a lot of quantum states that would have essentially the same entanglement structure as the thermal state. So pretty much any kind of typical state in that ensemble would have the same entanglement structure, and we'd say that all of those would essentially at the classical level be dual to the same geometry. So yeah, you could basically have two different quantum states, and then at the level of classical geometry, they might be the same.
Well, I actually had one question that I'll just take advantage of this time to ask you. So you've been looking at these energy conditions that come out of negativity of relative entropy and so on. And in GR, people often use these conditions to rule out what they think of as pathological spacetimes.
Right.
Are there any kind of qualitative pathologies that you can identify that are ruled out by the conditions you've been looking at?
Yeah, I mean, so let's see. I'll give you one example. So this example comes by. So I'm thinking about spherically symmetric spacetimes. With a certain amount of total mass, okay. So I could have, a star made of any kind of matter that I could imagine in any consistent theory of quantum gravity, and so that's described by some translation invariant state in a field theory on a sphere. And so one thing I could do would be to, so I'm going to divide the field theory, sorry, okay, let me not confuse things. Okay, so here's my field theory. This is the spherically symmetric geometry it describes. And then in the field theory, I'm going to consider a hemisphere. And one of the things that should be true is that So there's something called, there's something called relative entropy, where you compare the state of the field theory on the hemisphere in this excited state, in this excited translation invariant state, to the vacuum state. Okay, there's some basic quantum mechanical constraint that says that quantity has to be positive. Okay, so I could translate that to geometry, and what it tells me is that. So now I think about the area of the surface that intersects the spacetime. And so if I took all that matter away, the area would be different than the area with the matter in there. Okay. And so the positivity of relative entropy actually tells me a basic constraint on spherically symmetric spacetimes like that, And it restricts how much a certain amount of mass can change that area. So so that's just one example based on one constraint, but it gives you a restriction on, across all consistent theories of gravity, well, how much could my matter, a certain amount of mass, deform the space-time, and there's just an upper bound to that. So that's a good example. So I think we really learn some interesting new things that I wouldn't be able to derive in another way. Oops.
Very Hi. Open-ended question.
Okay.
Entropy normally in cooking means how many bits of information we can send from the source. What would be the analog of common law context in that theory?
Okay, probably a really good question. I'm going to open that one up to the floor if any of the it from qubit experts have thought about that. So I don't have a good answer, but
yeah. Well, there are multiple inequivalent definitions of quantum Kolmogorov complexity. And the reasonable ones most of the time agree with the entanglement entropy. So qualitatively, with probability one, these large systems will give you the same answer, I think. All right, are there any more questions? If not, let's thank Mark for a beautiful talk.
For more, please visit us at stanford.edu.